Okay, good evening, and welcome to Wednesday night Bible study. We're in chapter 2 of Colossians, and we're down to verse 20. So that leaves us four verses in chapter 2, and then we'll go on into the third chapter. Of course, this little book only has four chapters, but boy, it is full of good stuff, as the preacher says. Good stuff. And the first couple of chapters, and I'll get to, I'll begin with an introduction. Paul speaks to the doctrine of the church. He speaks to the doctrine of the church. I've told you that the cult of Gnosticism was pumping their poison into the church, and Paul penned this letter. God inspired him to pen this letter to correct all of the false teaching that was. The church was hearing. And so the first two chapters really are doctrinal. In the last two chapters, he begins to speak to our life in Jesus Christ, how we are to live our lives, what manner of person ought we. It's not good enough just to have doctrine. We're supposed to obey it, aren't we? Huh? And so you can sit on the front row or the back row or whoever you are in the church, know everything about what we believe, but if you don't practice it, then you're not a light unto the lost world, are you? And so this is what the last two chapters deal with, is us being that light that the doctrine of Christ allows us to be. Okay, verse 20. And Paul said, "Wherefore, if ye be dead with Christ from the rudiments of the world, why, as though living in the world, are you subjected to ordinances? Touch not, taste not, handle not, which are all to perish with the using, after the commandments and the doctrines of men." Now, and this is what the scriptures teach, isn't it? That once we become alive in Christ, we are dead to the world. And that's what he's saying here. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 says, "Ye who were at times dead in trespasses and sins." Now, he's talking to the church there. There's two different types of deaths. We were dead to Christ when we were in sin. And then we are born again, we become alive to Christ and dead to sin. Does that make sense? Because the first Adam, we died. The last Adam, we're alive. And this is what he's saying here. So, if you are dead with Christ, if we have died with Christ, died to the world, just like Christ died for us, that we could overcome the world, and he resurrected to life the third day, and then we have died with Christ and to the world, and then the baptism is symbolic to the resurrection that that we are have risen with Christ Jesus. And he says, "Why through living in the world are you subjected to ordinances or laws, commandments?" And it says, "Touch not, taste not, handle not, which all are to perish with using after the commandments and the doctrines of men." Look at it this way. I like the analogy. I don't know where I got it. I don't think I'm smart enough to have come up with this myself. But it's very obvious once you see it. It's easy to understand. My life in this body is like an Ishmael and an Isaac. Ishmael was the firstborn. Isaac was the secondborn of Abraham. Ishmael was the son of the flesh. Isaac was the son of the promise. And it continues on. Ishmael was a wild man. Isaac was the man of hope. And out of his loins would come the blessed Lord Jesus Christ. And so, this right here, this flesh, we're in this world. Christ didn't save us to take us out of the world. He saved us to transform us into the kingdom of his dear son. God saved us through Christ to conform us, transform us into the kingdom of his dear son so that we could overcome the world. Now, wouldn't it have been wonderful if he could have just took Ishmael and done away with him? You know, this right here, the son of the flesh, Hayward Embry's son, Henry Embry's son, Jackson Embry's son, all the way back to Adam Embry, you know. Or if you're a Smith, Adam was a Smith. If you're a Wright, Adam was a Wright. Because we all came from Adam. But when Christ, when we become alive in Christ, it didn't mean that the old man, the dead man, was completely done away with. Here he is. I face him every morning. Every morning I face him. He never goes away. Ishmael never went away. He's tormenting the Jewish people, the Ishmael, Isaac's descendants to this day. They don't even know why. I'd say some of them don't even know why they have such animosity toward each other. But it's because God chose Isaac over Ishmael, and Ishmael's a wild man. Gary Emery's a wild man. I'm telling you, and I know it's kind of funny. It might be a little humorous, but without Christ, I'm as lost as I ever was. This body is as lost as it ever was. And we're going to really get into that in chapter 2. So Ishmael was a wild. Ishmael never went away. Even though Isaac came along and the promise came through Isaac, and we've been studying on Sunday morning, and Brother Sammy's doing a great job. You know, Jacob and then Judah, and out of Judah came Perez, and out of Perez, and the lineage comes right on down through the generations there in Matthew chapter 1 unto Jesus Christ. But it was the second born that got the blessing. Is that not right? The second born got the blessing. It's the same with you and I in this world. Gary Emery born 68 years ago of the flesh, the Ishmael Gary. But about 23 years later, I was born again. And that new man receives the blessing, receives the inheritance, receives eternal life. And so, but I'm in this body and I'm still in the world, but I'm not of the world. And because of this new birth, I can overcome the world. And I don't have to do the things that I once did. I don't have to go where I once loved to go. Because God has saved me, just like He saved you. And He has given us a new life. And we're dead to the world. Wherefore, if you be dead with Christ from the rudiments, here it is, of this world, why is there living in the world? And I read that. The commandments are here. And you say, Brother Gary, are we under the commandments? Yes, we are. Well, yes, we are. They're all summed up in two. Love God the Father all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second is likened to it. Love your neighbor as yourself. On this hang all of the law and the prophets. If you keep those two, you'll keep it all. So then, look at verse 23. Which things have indeed a shoe of wisdom in will worship and humility, neglecting of the body, not in any honor to the satisfying of the flesh. Chapter 3. If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God. Seek the things which are above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God. One writer I read somewhere said, where you stand and walk depends on where you sit. Where you stand and walk, or how you stand and walk, depends on where you sit. And this writer said that he was attending a Senate meeting at Washington, D.C., and Hubert Humphrey, I believe, was the senator. And he got up to speak, and he made that statement. He said, where you sit is how you'll stand. In other words, all the Republicans was here, all the Democrats was here, and boy, if that those words were true then, they're really true now, aren't they, as divided as Congress is. And it's true in Christ Jesus. It's true as a Christian. Where you sit, if you sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, then that will determine how you stand and walk. How you stand and walk. And that's what the Bible says. He has made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, right? Well, where does Christ sit? At the right hand of the Father. And we're connected with God through Jesus Christ. If we're a part of Christ, then we're a part of God. And it's all spiritual. Paul wrote to the church and said it's a mystical church. It's beyond our understanding, but we have this connection. We have this connection with Christ, and therefore we have this connection with heaven. We have the connection with those who have gone on. Now, I'm not like some religions that believe that our loved ones are in heaven looking down on us, watching over us. We have Christ Jesus in heaven looking down on us, watching over us, not our loved ones. I don't understand that part of it, that, you know, how we get to heaven. When we get to heaven, will we be upset because someone we love didn't make it? I don't know about that. All I know is that it's Christ Jesus who sits in heaven and cares for us and is watching over us, not my grandma or not my grandpa. But we do sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on things of the earth. Not on things of the earth. Have you thought about that? Set your affection on things above, not on, and no one would be more worthy to write this verse of scripture than the Apostle Paul. He was sold out to God. His devotion, his love, his service was to God and God only. He said, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ which lives within me. Boy, isn't that a wonderful statement? And he was completely sold out. He said, I'm in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to go on and be with the Lord, but it is more profitable that I stay in this world. Not too many people with an honest heart could say that. Do you agree, Brother Kevin? I mean, you know, I love the Lord, but I get to thinking about my grandbabies and every grandma should have said amen. I get to thinking about my grandbabies and, I'm hoping to see them grow up and I hope I live long enough to, you know, be there at their wedding and graduations and all of that stuff. But and that's okay. But I'm telling you, there is a higher calling and there's a greater purpose in this world. Look, you remember the story of Joshua and Caleb and how that all these Israelites, they got to the land of Canaan. All they had to do, if I understand the scriptures right, is cross over Jordan and they're home free, right? Well, let's send some spies. Let's go in and check the land out. They sent a recon team. If you've ever been in the army, then you know what a recon team is. A recon team is not there to make contact with the enemy. We worked, our recon team was Echo Recon, is what we knew them by. And they was like a 7-8-man team, and they'd just go into the bush collect intelligence, you know. And their purpose was not to make contact with the enemy, even though they'd stumble upon them. This was the 12 spies. They went in as a recon team to spy the land, to view the land, and come back and bring a report. Well, you know the story. Only Caleb and Joshua brought a true report. You know why? Because they had their affection set on Canaan, didn't they? The land of promise that God promised Abraham. So everybody, God started with the age of 20, and everybody from there up except Caleb and Joshua died in the wilderness. This means yes, right? So how did Caleb and Joshua make it through all of those years, 40 years of wandering and all of the things that come upon them? Because they had their affection set on Canaan. They wanted Canaan. Remember what Moses told Caleb? You know, Caleb, I'm going to give you my word that you can have that mountain when you get there. You can have, and 40 years later, Caleb said, I want that mountain. I'm more able as I was when I was 40, and I'm 85 now, and I'm going to take that. Because that's how we make it, guys. You know, We are of this, we are in this world, but we are not of this world. Let's set our affections on things above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God, and not on the things of this world. I think Paul said in what, 2 Corinthians 4:18, while we look not at the things which are seen, but the things that are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things that are not seen are eternal. Hallelujah. That's why I want all my young ones to be saved, you know. Because one day, old Brother Gary, Papa, is going to leave them. But they can follow. They can come, and they will. They will. All right, and this is what he's encouraging the church, that now you've got the right doctrine, let's put it to work, okay? Let's put it to practice. Verse 3, for ye are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. Ye are dead, you're dead to this world, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Wow. He's gonna take care of it. The things that we cannot understand or do for ourselves, God's gonna take care of all of that through Christ Jesus. Somebody want to comment? Comment on verse 4. That's a good verse. No comments. Do you think that which appearing was he talking about? The second advent or the rapture? The second advent or the rapture? That's when we're going to glory, isn't it? In glorified bodies. Now, our spirits will come back with Christ, but out of the dust that these bodies make, God's going to recreate a new body, and then these bodies will be redeemed at that time, and we're going to appear in glory with him. But we need to keep our affections in the right place, don't we? Lest we become reprobates. Mortify, put to death is the word mortify out of the Greek. Put to death, therefore, your members which are upon the earth. Now, wait a minute. What kind of preacher would call out sin and specify sin? You know, I'm going to tell you something. I listen to a lot of preachers, but all you get is generalization of sin anymore, right? Just generalization of sin. And that's where old Brother Gary gets in trouble, and Paul perhaps got in trouble, but look, he gave a whole list, and it gets pretty deep. Therefore, mortify, put to death, therefore, your members which are upon the earth. Fornication. Does everybody know what fornication is? Sexual immorality in general, okay? Now, you could run the definition a little deeper, but that pretty much covers it. Fornication, uncleanness, lustful impurity, and boy, I tell you, you read this verse and look at the world. When, Brother Gary, what do you mean? Anything you turn on that stupid television, it's there, isn't it? I mean, this is there. It covers it. Those Pentecostal preachers back in the day when they was preaching against the television and spitting and slobbering and speaking in tongues and all the things, and I'm not condemning them. I'm not trying to be funny, or I'm not condemning them. But I'm telling you, I know I've been in Pentecostal services and preached in their churches, actually. And, you know, don't you think they had it right? Yeah. And then from the television, we go to the internet, and it just keeps getting worse instead of better. And we think we couldn't live without a television. We sure can't live without the internet, you know. I mean, most people couldn't run their businesses these days if it wasn't for the internet. But uncleanness, inordinate affection, just evil, evil affection, evil lust in your flesh, things that are off limits to the Christian, off limits, should be off limits to the world, but are not. Evil concupiscence, evil concupiscence, just base or evil desires. Covetousness, which is idolatry. That's just greed, isn't it? Greed. Never satisfied with what you have. You want more. You're not satisfied with your wife. You want the neighbor's wife. You're not satisfied with your husband. You want the guy on the assembly line that you're working with or at the office. Just not satisfied. I think I mentioned it maybe Sunday. You got $100,000. You want $200,000. You know. Now let's go back what we talked about. Where's this come from? Where does this desire, greed, fornication, evil concupiscence, uncleanness, where does it come from? Right here. The flesh. So when he said, set your affections on high where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God, if you do that, then there's no place for verse 5. He said, put them to death. It's like, your appetite, you know. And God knows, you can look at me and tell that I've had a real good appetite this winter. You have to. And I've noticed, and one of the hardest things to do is to quit eating if you like to eat. And so what has to happen? You can run 20 miles a day, but if you don't cut back on your eating, you're not going to lose much weight. You can't burn off enough calories to compensate for what you eat if you're overeating the way that, and I'm just going to put myself there like I do, or have been this winter. And it's the same thing with these sins that he's mentioned here. If a Christian person is caught up in this, it won't get better. It'll just get worse, and you'll gain more and more and more weight unless you do something about it, unless you mortify it, unless you put it to death. And the only way I can lose weight is quit eating, I'm telling you. Just crash, you know. And that's what he's saying here. You can't just satisfy a little bit of your flesh with this, because it'll control you and it'll just get, you know, you'll never have enough of these things that he's mentioned here if they are a part of your life. You'll never have enough. For which thing's sake the wrath of God cometh upon the children of disobedience. Can anybody define wrath? Wrath and anger are pretty much the same, except wrath is more or less an outburst, a demonstration of anger. Let me give you an example in Scripture. How about the flood, Noahic flood, the antediluvian flood? When God's wrath was kindled against the earth and he destroyed everybody, but who? Noah? What Jonah was it? It was Noah. Then another example of God's wrath in the Bible being poured out. Sodom and Gomorrah is another example. And it's coming again. He says it right here. I mean, we're told in the Revelation, we're told throughout the Scriptures that God's wrath is going to be kindled against the earth in the end times. It's coming. And verse 6 says, for which thing's sake the wrath of God cometh upon the children of disobedience. Now you look at verse 5 and those sins that he talks about there, and then look at the United States of America. Well, let's just bring it down to Muhlenberg County or Butler County where I live. It's all prevalent here. It's here. I mean, guys, look, divorce is epidemic in the land. It's epidemic. Why? Why? I'm not convinced that all of the people that I've known in my Christian walk that's got divorced, I'm not convinced they didn't love each other when they got married. Something happened. Something happened. And much of the time, especially in today's society, it's fornication or adultery when it comes to marriage. Adultery. Or it's financial issues. And many times they get themselves in debt that they can't get out, and instead of working through it, they separate. Yeah, I've seen it through the years. And so, you know, you think, why did he mention fornication, uncleanness, and order of affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry? Because these are, he specifies these sins because they have such a control upon the world, and especially our society today. Any thoughts? The wrath is coming. It's coming against those people who, Christians, the children of disobedience, in which ye also walked some time when ye lived in them. I'm going to turn and look at, for whatever reason, I'm going to turn and look at Ephesians chapter 2 for just a second. It's almost reading the same letter right here. He said, "And you hath he quickened, made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit of now, that now worketh in the children of disobedience." He's behind it, isn't he? Ain't that what it's saying, Shannon? He's behind it. The devil is behind the fornication and all these sins that he specified here. Among whom also we all had our conversation, our lives. Here it is, what I just read you in Colossians. In times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, wherewith he loved us. We were there. God has redeemed us. God has given us new life. And he has given us his spirit so that we can set our affections on things which are above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God. But while we're here on planet Earth, we have a responsibility not to live after the world. Or what? Yes. Yeah. That's right. Mm-hmm.
And in all of these that's mentioned, it's the same way. You know, the computer, the telephone, to greed, every single one of them, fornication, adultery, it's just a step in getting in the door.
Mm-hmm.
And I always remember the TV. That's all my brother George used to say.
Mm-hmm. And it's where... It just opens the door up to temptation, don't it? James said, "Blessed is the man who endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive a crown of life that fadeth not away." Then he said, "Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, because God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. For every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed." Now you can blame mama, you can blame daddy, you can blame the husband or the wife, but every individual Christian is tempted because of their own lust. And when lust is conceived, it brings forth sin. Sin, and when it's finished, brings forth death. And this is what Paul is talking about here. Stay away from it. Verse 8. But now ye also put off all these, anger, not only these fornication, uncleanness, and inordinate affection, those in chapter verse 5, but all these, anger. Now you say, Brother Gary, I'm not going to commit fornication. I don't believe you will. I'm not going to make material things my God. I'm not going to have inordinate affection toward others. But we forget, he also lists anger, verse 8, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. And these things are so acceptable, it seems like, in the church today. Anger. Let me tell you something. And if you don't get anything else out of me, what my tenure here, however long that's going to be, let quitting church be the last thing you'll ever do in this life. You stay in church. Well, I'm going to quit church when they put me in a 6-foot hole out there somewhere if Jesus don't come back. That's when I'm going to quit church. I'll quit then. You can say, oh, Brother Gary ain't here today. You know, I'm going to go to church somewhere. When y'all run me off here, I'm going to go somewhere. Sit on the back row and amen the preacher if need be. But, how many people get angry over some little old something that really could be worked through and they leave the church. Now, I'll tell you this. I won't stay here or anywhere else if the church becomes like the world, if we start teaching things other than the Word of God. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about you're in a body of Christ that you love and you believe in, and you believe that the Word of God is being ministered and people are being saved, and we're living spiritual lives, and the devil throws a wrench in that thing, and you up and get mad and run off. Don't let it be a part of who you are as a Christian. I couldn't be a part of every church. I'm not saying that. I'm saying if it gets to where you cannot worship at Duval's Chapel, you find you a Bible-believing church. But don't go in anger. Because if you can't love your brother whom you have seen, how are you going to love God who you don't see? You know. But this is what he's saying. He said, don't let anger and wrath, you know. You can be angry and sin not. If you're angry and sin not, you'll overcome it. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath, you know. If you sin through anger, then you better get forgiveness before the day's over, is what the scripture says there. Malice. Does anybody know what malice is? Yeah, it's kind of like an attitude of ill will toward others, toward another person. You know, hatred would cause this. It would be a part of it. Malice, blasphemy. What's blaspheme? Speaking evil against, didn't it? Speaking evil. If I blaspheme someone, if I speak evil against someone, I'm blaspheming them. You know, all sins shall be forgiven, but he that blasphemes the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven in this world or the world to come. Speaking evil against the Holy Ghost. Be careful what you say about the Holy Spirit. If you don't understand what's going on and people claim it's the Holy Spirit, and it's not contradicting the Word of God, then you better be careful what you say about it. But blaspheme's a serious thing. When you blaspheme someone, a person that is made in, that's a brother in Christ, filthy communication, tears me up, potty words, you know, just filth. It's almost today that you can put holy with any word out there, and it makes it all right. It's not all right. It's not all right. I know preachers that use little old pet potty words. Why? Why? I mean, when I was a kid, I was brought up in a lost home and my dad an alcoholic. And we didn't say them words then, you know. He would have got a hold of you. And now Christians use them. Dirty jokes, you know, or jokes that are, you know, could be borderline, you know, a little funny, but, you know, got a little dark side. Leave it alone. Best way to break them from doing it is turn around and walk off. Don't laugh at them. But this is what he's talking about. You know, you're the light of the world. You're it. You're the light of the world. Salt of the earth. You say, I don't think it'll take me to hell. It'll kill your witness with a lot of people. It will. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds. God hates a lying tongue, don't he? Isn't that what Proverbs says? Six things that God hates, the seven is an abomination unto him, a proud look, goes through all those six things. This, you know what? Seventh is he that soweth discord among the brethren. That's an abomination. But he hates a lying tongue. You see, when you lie, you're cooperating with the devil. When you tell the truth, speak the truth, you're cooperating with the Holy Spirit and the Lord Jesus Christ. Lying is a misrepresentation of truth. Not just a blatant lie, but when you deceive. It's like, what was it the fellow said? A half-truth is a whole lie. You know, I know people that they won't ever really come out and tell you a lie, but they'll just skirt all around it and tell you everything that you want to hear. And they leave the rest out, making you think that something is not like it is at all.
They won't lie to you, but they'll tell you the truth two or three different ways.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess that's. It's a half truth, so it's a full lie. Yeah. It's deception. That's what it is. It's deception. That's what the devil did to Eve, wasn't it? You won't surely die. God knows that in the day you eat thereof, you'll become as gods. That's what Mormonism teaches today. And have put off the new man, put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Renewed in knowledge. Can somebody explain that? Renewed in knowledge. I thought this is what the Gnostics were teaching. That it was all about knowledge, and that the smarter you got, the closer to God you got. You want to be renewed in God? The more you learn about the Lord Jesus Christ, the more you will renew yourself in the Lord. And I'm telling you, and that's what he's talking about here. Christians stay weak Christians because they choose not to know about Jesus Christ. Now, doesn't mean they're any less saved. But boy, I want to tell you something. Me and Brother Woody was talking this week, and I won't go into a lot of details, but every Christian needs to come to a point in their Christian walk where they fall in love with the Word. They absolutely fall in love with the Word. Now, I can't explain it to you. I can't explain it no more than I have tried to explain all these grandmothers-to-be and granddads-to-be what a grandchild is going to be like. You can't explain it. You got to experience it. But every Christian needs to come to a place in their Christian walk. You know, you would hope it would happen early on that they literally fall in love with the Bible, the Word of God. And then it will renew you in the Lord day by day as you dig into this wonderful, wonderful. And when you start connecting all the dots in the Bible, wow. It is precious, ain't it? It's precious. At the end of the lesson, I want to share something with you, so don't let me forget, okay? Once the camera goes off. Any thoughts or questions? Verse 10 then. And you have put on the new man. We read that. And we're going to try to close with verse 11. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. I want to read verse 10 with that, okay? And have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. See, there it is. Where there is neither Jew nor Greek nor Jew, circumcision, uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. You know, I preached a message here a couple weeks ago. Did I entitle it, The Cross is Enough, or The Cross is Enough? Have you ever thought about the genius behind the cross? The genius of the cross? The cross of Jesus Christ makes everybody the same. Everybody. Only God could come up with that, you know. Now, if you was going to save the world, you know, what would man, what would the most intellectual group of people on planet Earth come up with? They wouldn't come up with that. But the cross makes everybody the same. Can you think of it this way? You know the little book of Philemon, There's the slave Onesimus, and then the slave owner Philemon. Did you know they meet at the same place in Christ Jesus, and that it's at the feet of Christ? The slave and the slave owner, the rich, the most wealthy. You know, and I've witnessed this through the years, where somebody come into the church and they're wealthy, and everybody knows they're wealthy, and bang, that church wants to put them, make a position for them. That's not God. That's not God. Some of the best servants you'll ever see have trouble maybe paying their light bill or their utilities, you know, each month. To God, it's not about your status in society. It's not about your degrees. You may be a high school dropout or have a PhD, and you're the same in Christ Jesus. And that's what he's saying here. You know, the Gnostics was saying, the more you know, the more you're educated, the more you learn, the closer to God you are. The Greeks, they mocked Paul, and Paul was brilliant. They mocked him on Mars Hill. The Jew says you have to be circumcised. The Gnostic said that you had to be circumcised. But Paul said that circumcision or uncircumcision, that matter. Barbarian. The barbarians, the Greeks looked down on them. They were uneducated, unlearned, and they were some of the lowest in society. But then there was the Scythians, and they were the lowest of the low. But Paul groups them all right here together, don't he? The Jew and the Gentile, man, they hated each other. But the Gentiles were brilliant. We preach Christ to the Jew, a stumbling block, to the Greeks, a foolishness, but to us who are saved, he's the power of God. You know, they were so completely different, but in Christ Jesus, they're all the same. All the same. All the same. The barbarians and the Scythians are right there with the Greeks and the Jews. But Christ is all and in all. I'm glad it's that way. I'm glad that 46 years ago, I found this Christ that Paul wrote so much about in the New Testament. I've known wealthy Christians and I've known poor Christians. But I've never seen one. I've never seen a Christian that was placed any higher by the power of God and the Spirit of the Lord and the born-again experience, any higher than another one. Now, like I said, churches may do it. Churches may elevate certain people in that congregation, but not Jesus. I used to tell Belmont, it doesn't matter if they come in there, and I'll preach it here, and they got a $3,000 Armani suit on, or they got their clothes at a yard sale or a Goodwill store, and neither one of that's wrong. It doesn't matter. We treat them like princes and princesses because that's how God sees them. We won't all agree. We won't all see. And that's what makes the church so beautiful, isn't it? We don't all have to be alike. None of us are alike, except we have the same like precious faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Any questions? Anything? All right. Thank you for coming out tonight. And we're going to pray. Brother Mike went and had some tests earlier this week, and they've got a plan for him as far as some treatments. And Ben, I just talked to Holly about an hour ago, and if you hadn't heard, his surgery went well. The prognosis looks good, but he's in a lot of pain, real sore. They had to make another incision. I think they used the same incision, just opened it back up. But anyway, he's confident everything's going to be okay with him. Any other prayer requests? Amen. Amen. Is that it? Sister Amber, is the camera off? Just go ahead and turn that off then.